Students, welcome back. So today we are going to start another topic of chapter 5, principles of inheritance and variation. In this chapter already we have covered about the introduction about the different terms which are related to this chapter. So here we will start with the genetics. We know that genetics is what? It is the study of heredity and variation. Fine. So this, what is this heredity? The process by which the characters are passing from parents to the subsequent offspring, it is known as what? It is an inheritance and it is a part of heredity. So after passing the character, what are the changes which can be occur in the subsequent generation? We will study all about it. So here the major contribution of all about this inheritance was done by the Gregor John Mendel. Okay, that's why he was also known as the father of genetics, because he has done so much work in this field. And if we'll talk about the birth, 1822 and died in 1884. So in this period he has contributed more towards the field of this inheritance. As he was from the agriculture background, his father was a farmer, and he's from very poor family. That time what he wants to become? He wants to become the teacher, but he was not able to qualify the preliminary examination for the teacher. So after getting depressed, he became the monk in the Austria. So here he was born in Austria and from the agriculture background, so he know most of the thing about the agriculture. He know more about the crops, which season is suitable for which crop and how we have to grow it. So he is very good in all these things. That's why he was interested to work upon these biological field. So during that time when he was monk there in his garden, he has done some experiment in what? In pea plant. Okay, but from where he has taken all these knowledge before that? Okay, before, after becoming the monk, and he was interested towards the agriculture, or he was towards the this genetics parts. That time he went to University of Vienna. Okay, in 1851 he went to Vienna and almost spent 2 years there, and he taken the degree of what? The degree in the natural science as well as mathematics. You will very surprised that Mendel was not a biologist, he was the mathematician. He know everything about the mathematics part, but he is interested towards it. So he has applied this mathematics part in the biology and find the appropriate result. So there he influenced by the physics teacher, he was influenced by the biologist. Those teachers gave him the idea to work upon it. Okay, in the physics part they said to them to study about the biology related to the mathematics. He said to him that you should work according to the mathematic tools. He should work with the mathematical tools and applied this on the biological science. And another biologist who gave him idea about what? About the variation. He said that nothing can be same, there must be a variation. Okay, so you have to study about it. After returning from there, Mendel did his experiment in pea plant, okay, in his garden. And what type of pea it was? Garden pea. This question is important, and scientific name of pea is Spicum sativum. So there what he did, he worked upon these pea plant for the several generation. Now, after doing this experiment, he come to know that how the characters are passing from the parents to the subsequent offspring. So another question arises here, why he chose the pea plant? What was the reason? Okay, he can take another plant also, another crop also, but he worked upon pea because there are some reasons, there are some advantages of this plant. The first one is easy availability, that this plant is available very easily, and the handling of this plant is also very easier. Another point is short life cycle. We know that pea plants take short time to complete its life cycle, and this aspect is important for the research, because if we are going to do any research, if the life cycle will be short, what will happen? We can get more and more result in the short span of time. Otherwise, it will take so much time and we cannot conclude our result. So this can be a advantages for the bandle, that if it was a cycle was small or the life cycle was short, what happens? He can get more and more crop, more and more yield in a single season. And another one is the produces large number of seed. As you have seen that in case of pea plant, in a single pod we can get 4 to 5 seed on an average. So here, if he has grown the pea plant, so what happened? He can get more and more number of seed, and if the more number of seed will be there, the sample size will be more, and if sample size will be more, then the probability of appropriateness will be more. So it can be the advantages. Another point about the pea plant, it is a bisexual flower, or we can say hermaphrodite flower. What is the meaning of bisexual flower? That both the male and female reproductive part present on the same flower. And what will be the advantage of this one? If the both reproductive part will be on the same flower, what will happen? It will be a naturally self-pollinated crop. Why? Because there is no chance for the natural cross-pollination. So if flower will be bisexual, what will happen? There will be a natural self-pollination, but it doesn't mean that there will be no cross-pollination. So cross-pollination can be possible in case of bisexual flower, and we know that by the techniques of hybridization we can make the cross-pollination. How? With the help of imacculation, we can remove the anther part and the flower will become the female part. So with the help of this, we can go for the natural self-pollination as well as by the artificial cross-pollination can also be possible in these types of flowers. Another one is number of easily detectable contrasting character. This point is very, very important. Why? Because in case of pea, there are different contrasting means different types of character. Okay, so here in case of pea, there can be a different characters which Mendel has taken in account to study or to research on the pea plant. So here I have mentioned some 7 characters which the taken by the Mendel. And what are the different characters? The characters can be the plant height, or we can say stem height. About the flower, he has taken flower color as well as flower position. In case of pod, he has taken pod shape as well as pod color. In case of seed, he has taken shape as well as color. As we have done that, there is some difference between characters and trait. Whenever we are talking about these part, we are talking about the character. Likewise, if we'll talk about in humans, we will talk about the character. What does it mean? Example, hair color or the eye color, this can be the character. And what can be the trait, the features about these characters, what will happen? It will become the trait. For example, in case of humans, if hair color can be black or it can be brown. In case of color of eyes, it can be black, it can be brown. So these are what? These are different traits of particular character. So here he has taken in account 7 characters which we have discussed, and it can be what? It can be 2 contrasting trait. What can be? The first one, he has assumed that it can be the dominant one, and another one is the recessive one. And we have done that what is dominant character or what is dominant trait? That trait which can express itself in the heterozygote condition. Okay, so we have done that. What about the dominant and recessive character? This dominant character can be express itself in the homozygous as well as in heterozygous condition, but about the recessive character or the recessive trait, it cannot express where? In the heterozygote condition or in case of homozygous condition. Okay, but yes, in case of homozygous condition, it can be, it can express itself, but not in the heterozygote condition. Fine. So here, if we'll talk about the plant height, it can be tall or it can be dwarf. Flower color can be violet, flower color can be white, and flower position can be axial or it can be terminal. So what is the meaning of axial and terminal? If you will see here, For example, if flower is producing at the tip of the plant, what you will say? It's a terminal one. And if the flower will produce where? At the stem position or in the axillary position, you will say the position of flower is axillary one. So here the dominant character is what? The axillary position. If flower present at this position, when flower is present at the top position, it will become the terminal one. Okay, now the pod shape. The pod shape can be inflated or it can be constricted. Inflated means that it will be the swollen one, and constricted, it's not that much pod in, seed inside it. And another one is pod color. Pod color can be green or it can be yellow. And if we talk about the seed shape, it can be round or wrinkled. Round means something round, and wrinkled, if you see the pea pod, pea seed, it can be wrinkled also. Okay, it is a recessive character. And seed color can be yellow as well as green. Now, whenever we are representing the dominant character, we are representing with the higher case or the upper case. And whenever we are representing the recessive trait, we are representing with the lower case of that same cap of same alphabet. For example, if I have taken tall with the capital T, so here I will take dwarf with the same alphabet but in the lower case. Same thing we have followed in the other trait also. Fine. So in Mendel's experiment, what he has done, he has taken 7 characters, and sometimes he has taken one character at a time, and in other cases he has taken 2 or more characters at a time. That's why we have done monohybrid cross, dihybrid cross. Okay, what is monohybrid? In which we are studying one character at a time, it is known as monohybrid cross. And when we are considering 2 traits or 2 characters at a time, it is known as what? It is known as a dihybrid cross. Okay, now we have done about the Mendel's experiment. Now if you will see all these things, he was able to explain the law of inheritance. He has given that how the characters are transferring from the parents, how these this height character will be transformed from parents to the offspring. All it can be done by the Mendel's experiment, and that's why here he has given law of inheritance. But he got his recognition of this work after his death. Whenever you in that period he was not recognized by anyone. Okay, so what would be the reason behind it? The reason behind the unrecognition of Mendel's works, that Mendel's did his work very fast, or we can say that with the time of ahead. How? Because that time people was not aware about the genes, about the character, about the chromosome. They were not aware about all these things, so they cannot relate this work with the genetics or related to the biology. Another reason behind it, that as I have said, that Mendel was mathematician, so he has done his experiment related to the mathematical tools, and biologist was not able to understand more about this mathematics part, and that's why he has not accepted this theory. Another reason that in Mendel's work has not been published in very renowned journals, because that journal was not circulated that much. Okay, so these are some reasons that he was not recognized for his work. But after we can say after in 1900 or 60, after almost 16 years, he was recognized for his work when the work was rediscovered by the 3 scientists. Who are they? Hugo de Vries, Karl Korens and Shermak. So these scientists conducted their experiment or research in a separate area. Okay, they have not worked together, they worked separately, and all they have concluded that yes, the Mendelian's work was good and it was the fine. That's why after that he got recognition for his work in 1900. Okay, so here we have done about the Mendel's work, about his discovery. So now we will discuss about how he has done his experiment, what was the procedure behind it. Okay, so here I have given some steps which we will study more in the coming part. So here what he has done, formation of pure line. Okay, just we will go through it. First what he has did, formation of pure line. Then after forming the pure line, he has done hybridization between this pure line. Okay, and after that he got the F1 generation, and he has gone the self pollination of this F1 hybrid, and after F1 generation he has taken the F2 generation, where he got different phenotypic ratio and genotypic ratio there. Fine. So now we will discuss more about the procedure, how he has done this experiment. Before that, how this Mendel's work, because he has done his work on these 7 characters. So he was very lucky that he has not gone through the linkage. Whatever the work, if he has taken 2 character at a time or the 1 character at a time, it was not present on the same chromosome, or they are very distant to each other. For example, if I say it's a chromosome and the gene for any character, it was not present on the same chromosome. If it was present in the same chromosome, they are different. For example, one gene is controlling here and another gene is controlling here. They are very distant to each other. If it would be at the same place or very close to each other, what will happen? There should be a linkage. And if linkage would be there, he was not able to explain all this theory. So he was very lucky to not go through this linkage theory or linkage experiment. Fine. So here, now we will discuss about the different. So now we will study that how Mendel conducted his experiment. As we have said, he has taken character. For example, if I will say the plant height, okay? If I will take the character plant height, so the contrasting character can be what? It can be tall or it can be dwarf. And we are representing tall with a capital one and the dwarf with the smaller one. Right. So here what he did, in the first part he has taken parent all which are tall, and here he has crossed with the dwarf parent. Before that, as I have said, that in procedure of the this Mendel's experiment, he has made the pure lines. Okay, so this is one of the pure line and this one is the another pure line for the dwarf. So how he has made this pure line? If we'll talk about the pure line, so what is the method of getting pure line? If I will cross the tall plant with the tall plant for how many generation? For 6 to 7 generation, what will happen? If it will be tall and it will also be tall, the progeny will also be tall. So if any dwarf it will get in this generation, we will discard it, and again we are going for the tall with tall. So when we will continue this process up to 6 to 7 generation, the gametes will get pure, or this variety will get pure, and we have developed the pure line. Okay, so this is pure line for what? For the tall character. Now if I say that I have to make the pure line for the dwarf, so how I will make it? Again, if I will cross this dwarf with dwarf, what I will get here? Again dwarf. So after 6 to 7 generation, I have attained this dwarf variety, which is this one. Okay, so what is that? It's a pure line for the tall, as well as it is a pure line for the dwarf. Okay, now we can say, whenever we can see or we can observe by our eyes, this character is known as what? It can be the phenotype. So what will be the phenotype here? Tall as well as dwarf. And this one relates to what? It is a genotype. Okay, and these are the parental characters. Now when we will cross this one, what he found, the Mendel's found that there will be a combination of tall as well as dwarf. Before the Mendel's experiments, it was assumed that there is a blending theory. Okay, what was the blending theory? If we are mixing any 2 character, it will mix each other. They will not remain their character. But in this Mendel's theory, what he was expected that he will get some different types of plant in the F1 generation. Okay, he was expected, but he was not found the middle one. For example, the tall plant is this one and this one is a dwarf plant. And what he would expect it, that this should be the middle of this toilet dwarf. But he has not found this one. How? If we will make the gametes here, capital T and capital T, as well as here also, small t, as well as small t. So, with the help of Punnett square, we can draw, how? This one. Okay, we have taken this part, capital T, and this small t, small t. So, what you will find here, when you will match this one, when you fix this one, capital T, small t, capital T, small t. So, you are getting all, or we can say 100%, what type of character? Tall character. So, here, what will be the phenotype of the F1? The phenotype of F1 will be the tall. As well as if you will talk about the genotype of F1 generation, we can say it is heterozygote tall. What type of tall? Heterozygote tall. Okay, the expected thing he has not found. So here he got that all plants were tall. Again, he was curious that in F2 generation what would happen. So he has done again the self-pollination. Okay, self-pollination of what? Self-pollination of this F1 hybrid. So as we have discussed in the procedure, the first part is that formation of pure line. After formation of pure line, there would be hybridization of this F1 with what? With the another one, and here we are going for the self pollination. So here how many plants which we are getting, all they are of tall height, and we have done self pollination. When we go for the self pollination, now what will happen? Again we will form the gametes of this capital T and small t, and capital T and small t. So after that we will get capital T and small t. Here also we will get the gametes capital T and small t. Now again if you will draw the Punnett square, it would be easier to make it the crosses here. How many? Capital T and small t, capital T and small t. Okay, again if you will make crosses, capital T, capital T, capital T, small t, small t, sorry, capital T, small t, and small t, small t. So what you are getting here, what Mendel has concluded, that he was shocked that in F2 generation again he got the dwarf plant which was not expressed where in the F1 generation. Now what would be the ratio? The capital T, capital T, and the capital T, small t, again capital T, small t, and small t, small t. So you can say that out of 4, we are assuming that 4 plants are there. So out of that, 1 are purely what, tall, or we can say homozygote tall, and 2 are heterozygote tall. What are they? Heterozygote tall, and another 1 is homozygote dwarf. So in F2 generation, he found that this dwarf character again expressed where? In this F2 generation. So this would be the what? This would be the phenotypic ratio. Phenotypic means that we can assume that all these are tall. But genotypically they are different. Whenever we are talking about the phenotypic ratio, what would be the phenotypic ratio? It would be the different one. We can say the 3 would be the tall. The phenotypic ratio, I am writing here, the phenotypic ratio would be 3:1. Why? Because 1 and plus 2, all they are representing tall height. And the genotypic ratio is what? Genotypic ratio is 1:2:1. Okay? 1:2:1. In which 1 is what? Homozygote tall, and 2 is heterozygote tall, and 1 is homozygote dwarf. So he has done his experiment like this in F1 and F2 generation and found that what is happening, the factor is transferring from the parents to the offspring. Okay, in F1 generation as well as in F2 generation. But here, instead of saying genes, he had used term factor. What he used the term? Factor. The factor term used by the Mendel. But later on what happened, as the research goes further, so we have said that gene, the factor and gene is the same thing, and due to this gene which is transferring from the parents to their subsequent generation. This is all about the Mendel's experiment. Okay, so what would be the inference here? The inference is that in F1 generation, the dominant character has been expressed and while the recessive character has not been expressed. While in F2 generation, we are getting different ratio of phenotypic as well as genotype. Fine. Now, the work which has been done by the Mendels, he has given some inferences also. The result which he got, as we have said, the character which is passing from the parents to the offspring, he has given some name which is known as factor. So what he has written, he observed that something was being passed on from parents to offspring. It is known as factor. And now we are using which term? We are using the term genes. Fine. And another point, inferences which he has given, genes are considered to the unit of inheritance. This point is very, very important. So what is the unit of the inheritance, or what we can say is passing from one generation to another generation? It is gene only. Okay, so this is about all about the Mendel's work, and in another session we will study about more about the Mendel's laws. For example, law of dominance, law of segregation, law of independent assortment. So we will discuss all about it. So here, one more important thing, that is Punnett square. As we have done our crosses with the help of Punnett square, it is the easier form to make the crosses. And if we'll talk about this method, it was given by the R.C. Punnett. This method is given by the R.C. Punnett, who was the British genetist. Fine. And if we'll talk about the definition of Punnett square, we can say that it is a graphical representation. It means that this type of square which we are forming here to show the crosses of the gametes, or the crosses which we are going to make, we can represent by this method. So to calculate the probability of all possible genotypes of offspring in a genetic cross. For example, if we are making the crosses, so what should be the probability of the particular character? For example, tall height, dwarf height. So what will be the probability we can conclude by this Punnett square method? As we know that this method is very mathematical, so here we can denote this expression with the binomial expression ax plus by by whole square. So here, how can we relate it here? If I will show in the crosses which we have made here, what was the ratio? 1:1, 2:1, and what was the total plants which we were getting there? 4. So out of 4, the ratio of homozygote tall was the 1:4, and 2:4 is for the heterozygote tall, and 1:4 for which? For the homozygote dwarf. When we will talk about this representation here, so if we can cut this one, 2 and 2. Okay, so we can say half of the gametes which we are getting here, they are what? They are tall, and half of the gamete which we are getting here, they are dwarf. If you will apply this one into this expression, so how we can get this expression? So we can do one thing, how 1/2 of the tall and half of the dwarf. Okay, so this expression can be expressed like this one. Okay, if we will solve this method again, we find the value of the ratio which we are getting in our crossing combination. Okay, so if we solve this one in the next session, we will discuss about this expression, how we can solve it. Okay, so first do it by yourself with the help of this expression. Fine. So that's all for this lecture, and in the next session we will start with the more important topics. That's all for here. Thank you.